Today is the seventh Sabbath of the great and the fearful day of Yahweh. It is the eighth day of the ninth month on his restored calendar. It is the 11th day of November on Satan's calendar. Concerning your failure to obey the Most High and rest on his set apart day, his word tells us in Leviticus chapter 26, verse 43, the land will forsake them, and it will delight in her Sabbaths, while it lies desolate of those who have delighted in their lawlessness. Because, he says, the doubling of this word puts a double emphasis upon it in the Hebrew language. Because, they have rejected my judgments, and their lives have loathed my statutes. These verses follow Yahweh telling us that he is going to send four major waves of seven of calamity upon you because of your doing so. This is a total of 28 admonishments that you are soon going to receive if you fail to turn back to him through that which he's restored at this time. It just so happens that today, on this seventh Sabbath, the day that he has led me to speak about this verse, is 28 days from the 1335th day of his servant Daniel's prophecy. The first four verses of this chapter tell us that if we will not bow down to idolatrous images of who he is, and if we will hedge about his Sabbaths and hedge about his statutes and his commandments and do them, that he will send rain to nourish our land. Most of you who are of the scattered descendants of Israel think that you are already blessed by the Most High because of all of the abundance that is in your land. What you fail to realize is that the rain that he is referring to in this prophecy and in others is not physical rain. His word tells us that he sends physical rain upon both the just and the unjust. The abundance that our lands contain in them is a result of Yahweh's blessing promises that he gave to us as a result of being descendants of Abraham. But this in no way means that he is pleased with you as individuals. On the contrary, you are soon going to see his hot indignation that he has for you because of your rebellion to him. You are going to see this up close and personal. The rain that he is referring to is his opening our eyes and unstopping our ears so that we can see and hear his word. He speaks of his word being sent down to us in the manner of the rain and the snow, in the manner that it is sent down from heaven in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 11. My word, says Yahweh, that proceeds forth out from my mouth is in this same manner. In the previous verse, he tells us that this same manner is referring to in the manner that the rain and the snow fall from heaven and water the earth, and they cause it to bring forth and to bud before they return, so that they will give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. In this manner, his word tells us, my word will not return to me void. It will accomplish that which I purpose, and it will prosper in that which I sent it to do. In the verses that precede this, he tells us that our ways are not as his way is, nor are our thoughts as his thoughts are. Therefore, this verse is telling us that he sent his word down from heaven in order for it to nourish us and to cause us to grow in oneness with him. His word is the unleavened bread of life that circumcises our hearts when we do it with the desire to become as he is. His opening our eyes and unstopping our ears is the rain that we must receive of in order to be nourished by him. This is the latter rain that he is going to send down from heaven at this time upon those of you who will turn back to him. The famine of this rain is the famine of hearing his word that is in the land at this time. The following verse of Leviticus chapter 26 tells us that he is not going to destroy all of you. He is not going to destroy those of you who will become the remnant. This is those of you who will turn back to him at this time. If you will turn back to him through that which he has restored and do so in both spirit and in truth, he will plant you in the millennium where you can grow to become part of the latter harvest into his family. But if you fail to do so, dying you will soon die. Yahweh concludes this chapter by telling us that these statutes and judgments of his Torah, referring to his commandments with his statutes and his judgments that he gave to us in the previous 25 chapters through the hand of his servant Moses, are what he is referring to in this prophecy for why he is going to send these four waves of seven of calamities upon you. If you refuse to turn back to his pathway that he has restored, you are going to have the four waves of seven of calamities of this Leviticus chapter 26 prophecy poured out upon you. This prophecy says so. The Most High has held back letting loose this time of affliction until now. It is what it is. Today on this seventh Sabbath that falls on the eighth day of the ninth month, we are only 10 days from the 18th day of the ninth month. The significance of this seventh Sabbath, 10-day waypoint, landing on the 18th day of the month of the ninth month is huge. I will explain how. There are 377 days that encompass this day and the day that precedes the day that your land is going to become desolate of you. This will be on the fifth day of the 10th month next year, the day that his word tells us that the city is smitten. There were 377 days from which he told his servant Noah to start loading the ark until he opened the ark's door. The reason why the 18th day of the month is significant is because it parallels three very significant waypoints that are recorded in the testimony of his word. Yahweh resurrected his only begotten son towards the end of the 17th day of the month. He did so at the ninth hour of the night watch. At the time of the Passover, at the time of the spring equinox, when there are 12 hours in a day and 12 hours in a night, this was at 3 a.m., the way that man reckons the hours and the day of the days and the nights at this time. I want to interject a correction here. In the last video, I made an error when I said that Matthew recorded that Yeshua died at the third hour. I had this wrong in my notes and I did not catch this error because I often point out in these videos that he died at the third hour of the afternoon, the way that we reckon the hours now. Matthew recorded that Yeshua died at the ninth hour at that time, which is 3 o'clock at the time of the spring equinox, according to how we measure the hours at this time. Anyway, I wanted to clear up this error. When Yahweh resurrected his only begotten son 3.5 days later, it was 3 hours before the 18th day of the first month began. But he did not ascend until the next morning after Mary appeared to him. This is why he did not allow Mary to touch him, as recorded in John chapter 20, verse 17. Therefore, Yeshua ascended into his Father's kingdom on the 18th day of the month. This three-hour gap parallels all of the Most High's references to 3 days' journey that he wove into the testimony of his word and into his end-time timeline. He rode into Jerusalem on the ass's colt on the 10th day of the first month. This means that he ascended to be with his Father 8 days later. This eight-day parallel to this is awesome. Yahweh closed the ark's door and sent the floodwaters gushing upon the earth at the same time of the second month, 3 hours before the 18th day of the second month began. And he marked his servant Noah at the same time of the seventh month, 3 hours before the 18th day of the seventh month began. This totals three references to the 17th day that also indirectly marks the 18th days of these 3 months that are recorded in the testimony of Yahweh's word. In lieu of how he has woven the number 4 into his word and into his end-time timeline, it is quite fitting that the Most High has now placed a fourth parallel to the 17th and the 18th days of the month into the testimony of his word. The 18th day of the ninth month is 3 days' journey from the eighth Sabbath of this period of time. This period of time began on the eighth day Sabbath that follows Yahweh's restored feast of 7-day feast of temporary dwellings. All of these parallels illustrate the remarkable design of the testimony of his word. I will expand on the significance of the 17th day of the month being 2 days' journey from the eighth Sabbath of this period of time in another video. The subject of the now is the 377-day waypoint and 7 days later and the 370 days that will follow. And these 370 days will be followed by the 7 days of the city being smitten. The reason why this 377-day waypoint is significant is because it encompasses the day before the fifth day of the 10th month next year. But there is more. The first 7 days of it encompasses the 24th day of the ninth month. This day is the seventh of the 7 days. Therefore, these 7 days parallel the 7 days of the 377 days that his servant Noah and his family loaded the ark. And concerning this seventh day, Yahweh's word tells us in Haggai chapter 2, and Yahweh's word came to Haggai a second time on the 24th day of the ninth month, saying, Speak to Zerubbabel, the governor or the head of Judah, saying, I will shake the heavens and the earth. I will overthrow the thrones of the kingdoms, and I will destroy the power of the kingdoms of the heathen, and I will overthrow their chariots, and those that ride in them, and their horses and their riders will be cast down, each man by his brethren's sword. In that day, saith Yahweh of hosts, I will bring Zerubbabel, my servant, the son of Shealtiel, saith Yahweh, and I will put a signature ring upon him, because I have chosen him, saith Yahweh of hosts. This signature ring is summed up by Isaiah 55:11 that I read to you earlier. After this 24th day of the ninth month, the day that parallels the Most High's closing the ark's door and sending the waters gushing upon the earth towards the end of it at about 3 a.m., the way that man reckons the hours at this time, there will remain 370 days encompassing before the fifth day of the 10th month. Yahweh's prophecy for the city being smitten on this day. There were 370 days from which Yahweh closed the ark's door until he opened it. Like I said, today's eighth Sabbath, it's the seventh Sabbath of this time, the great and the fearful day of Yahweh, is just 10 days from the 18th day of the ninth month, and the beginning of the 7 days that take us to the 24th day of the ninth month. You can write these incredible dynamics off as just mere coincidences if you would like to, but if I were you, I would read Leviticus chapter 26 with fear and trembling, that these four waves of seven might just be heaped upon you because of your rebellion to that which he gave to us through his servant Moses, like this prophecy tells us is going to happen. If the 24th day of the ninth month proves to be just another one of the many warnings that the Most High has woven into the testimony of his word, this by no means that this time of affliction is not at hand. I do not know, but I would not count on it. Plus, like I said earlier, today we are just 28 days from the 1335th day and his causing his word that he has put upon my mouth to no longer be put to silence. This will be just 12 days after the 24th day of the ninth month. I will also speak of the great reign of Ezra chapter 10 in a future video. This prophecy was given to us 4 days prior to the 24th day of the ninth month, on the 20th day of the ninth month. Like I keep saying in these videos, the testimony of Yahweh's word is indeed quite dynamic in testifying to the here and the now, and his wrath being at hand. Turn back and be not a partaker of his hot indignation, or else prepare to be a recipient of it. Thus saith Yahweh's word that is upon his servant Zerubbabel.